stars they wept, the morning sun was dead, the savior of the world was fallen, his body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him. One final breath he gave as heaven looked away. The Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave. The war on death was waged. The power of hell forever. Yeah.
All right, we are just about ready here. I think the guitarist, they call me high maintenance, so I think the guitarist got this one today. What do you think? If you will stand with us, we would like to start with a song. Thank you.
we're going into the city to celebrate the Passover. While he was being led out to become the Passover lamb. And we didn't have any idea. I was determined to celebrate the Passover in Jerusalem. I had traveled for over 1,500 miles. And when I got there, the city is an incredible sight. Not the sight I was expecting. The crowd seemed 10 times larger than the last Passover. There were angry mobs, people everywhere, people shouting the name Jesus, and people crying. Guards were making people step back as a man with a beam across his shoulders, bloodied beyond recognition, was making his way down the street. The guards were taking him to the place of the skull, Golgotha. And I was trying to make sense of this anger and all the shouting and the weeping. There was so much weeping. The Roman guards literally grabbed me and pulled me from the crowd, ordering me to pick up that man's cross. I had traveled a long way to celebrate. If I carried that man's cross, his blood would stain me, and I would be unable to celebrate the Passover. The Romans, they have authority over us. They can order us to carry it a mile, even further. I froze. I didn't know what to do. And then I saw him. Him. I saw what the fuss was all about. I saw him with my own two eyes. And I couldn't pull myself away from him. Or what was left of him. His body was mutilated to a point where he could barely see the man behind the blood. It was almost like pounds of beaten flesh walking upright. And then his eyes met mine. This was no criminal. This was not a crazed man with grandiose ideas. This was an encounter with the one who was sent, the Messiah. And he was carrying his cross step by step, barely able to stand. I told myself, don't make trouble with the Romans. Just carry the cross. Just pick it up, Simon. Forget about your Passover sacrifices and just do it. But as I put my arm around him, I felt the weight of the cross on my shoulders, on my back. And I was trying to help Jesus walk. His knees kept buckling under a weight that seemed to go beyond that of a wooden cross. He was carrying the weight of the whole world on his shoulders. But we kept on walking together. I tried to carry what I could, but he was carrying so much more. I could hear the insults at him, now at me. I could feel the spit, and I could feel his blood on my skin. I looked at the wounds and the scars all over his body. A crown of thorns had been mashed down on his head. Blood ran into his eyes. The people shouted, "Where's your heavenly Father now? Prophesy, you liar!" The mocking, the laughter, the insults. They took him to Calvary. They placed him on a Roman cross. They nailed his hands and his feet, and they put him upright. And I watched him. For 6 hours, he strained to stretch himself so he could get enough air into his lungs. And I looked down, and I saw the blood of Jesus staining my hands. I was so worried that his blood would make me unclean, when in reality, it's what makes me clean. He took his last breath, and he died. On that day, I picked up my cross. I helped Jesus carry my cross. Jesus hung and died on my cross.
Thank you, Simon. Take your Bibles, please. And we're going to go to Mark 15. There were notes handed out this morning in the bulletin, look kind of like this. Please take those out. I have some things to fill in the blank for you. If you didn't get a bulletin, just raise your hand and the ushers would be happy to hand you a note. This morning, what I want to address is the concept of encounters with Jesus, encounters with Christ. Many of you have come to know Christ over the years, and your life is changed. And what I'd like to say this morning is that Christ is in the business of changing lives. He was thousands of years ago. 2,000 years ago when this happened, and he is today too. And we invite you to consider Christ. I'm glad that each of you are here this morning. It's a great day. It's nice to see the sun. It's actually nice to see bare ground, isn't it? In Mark chapter 15, we're going to read some things about this particular man. And his name was Simon of Cyrene. It says, actually, just in Luke 23, they led Christ away and seized Simon of Cyrene, who was on his way from that country, and put the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. And so we have this man from Cyrene, which is in Libya, in our culture today. And Libya is west of Egypt. I just want you to envision where that is. You think of Egypt, and then you think of Libya just right next door to it. He's on the Mediterranean Sea. He was probably a black man who had come to Jerusalem to worship the Passover. He's a spiritual man. And he'd come there apparently more than once. But he was there this time to worship, and it was different there this time. This time it was an angry setting. You can feel it. Something was going on that was bigger than him. And he was standing in as a pilgrim in Jerusalem when the soldiers grabbed him from the crowd and said, "I want you to carry the cross." Because Jesus had been beaten so harsh that he could not do it anymore. The cross that we know of that Christ was crucified on was a Roman cross. And it, to get pulled together, is over 300 pounds of weight. It's very, very heavy. And it's rugged. It wasn't nice, smooth. It's a rough, hewn piece. It was, if you just take the crossbeam itself, somewhere between 75 and 125 pounds. And the cross that I have behind me here is an interesting cross. The story that goes with that is a really good friend of mine, Arnold Sharp, who's an elder here, made that probably 22, 23 years ago. And the wood that he got that cross from was a pig shed. The structure of it was from a pig barn. I just found that interesting because Jews are so kosher that they would have nothing to do with swine. And that's what the cross was made out of in our setting. So I just want you to think about that and ponder. When Simon was there in the crowd, he had brought his two boys, probably teenagers at this time, Alexander and Rufus. Mentions in Mark 15, 21. A certain man from Cyrene, Simon, the father of Alexander and Rufus, was passing by on his way from the country, and they forced him to carry the cross. They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull. And they talk further about the crucifixion. Now, if you were there in the crowd, standing there, and you were just there to celebrate, and then you see all this other things happening, and your dad gets pulled out to carry something that seems very vile, what would that do to you? I'm sure he felt the whip. I'm sure he felt the angst, the cruelness of all of it. What would you do as a young person watching that? Would fear strike your heart? Would anger? What would happen? You see somebody suffering like that. Jesus went down what we call the Via Dolorosa. It's called the Way of Suffering. And he suffered from where he had been beaten and the false trials. And then they made him march down that way to where he would be crucified. There's an interesting comment here about the two boys. Rufus's name is mentioned again in Romans 16:13. You don't have to turn there, but Paul writes at the end of Romans a greeting to many people who had become Christians. And it says there, "Greet Rufus, chosen in the Lord." Now, we don't know that this is the same Rufus, but wouldn't that be curious? That in the midst of him watching all this stuff that happened, he became a Christian. And he became a personal blessing to Paul. When we go through suffering, what happens to us? How do we handle suffering? And actually right now, there are several people who are suffering pretty significantly in our church. Things that are beyond their control. Christ suffered, but his suffering was for us. When I saw this particular drama that Paul did this morning, the phrase that strikes me very strongly is the last phrases that he spoke, which he said what? Christ carried. He says, "Christ carried my cross." You see, I've kind of always envisioned it too, that Christ is carrying his cross. We call it his cross. But Christ didn't deserve a cross. He had done nothing wrong. He had lived a sinless life. He was the Holy One of God. He was the great teacher, the great healer, who had done great things and mighty things to prove he was God. He was carrying a cross. But listen to this. The cross was not his. If you forget everything else I say this morning, remember that. Christ carried Simon's cross. Christ carried my cross. And Christ carried your cross. That makes a big difference, in my opinion. I think it's profound. You see, there were other men who were crucified that same day. They were criminals. They were bad men. They had done evil. They had done wrong. They had hurt people. And they were being crucified for their wrong. Christ was not. He carried, he hung, and he died on my cross and yours. Secondly, Christ bore my sin and shame on the cross. My sin and shame. When you were in grade school, or did you ever have anyone, when you had done something wrong, someone else step up and said that they had done it? You ever had that ever happen to you? And somebody else stands up and says, I did that, and they took the hit for you? That's a pretty powerful time. It's a time when you know you got it coming to you, but someone else takes it for you. That's what Christ did. He took my sin and shame on the cross. A little while ago, I was in Jerusalem myself, and we went to the place Golgotha. And we went to the place called the Skull, and you can actually see a skull there in the land. And they say this is where... What do you do when things like that happen? It's scary. You don't expect it, and there it happens. We as a people, you know, we live life all around us. And many people say, I wish I knew what was going to happen in my future. And quite frankly, I don't really want to know all that's going to happen in my future. I just want to know who holds my future. And for each one of you here this morning, you know, God has appointed you to be here. You know, you came on your own free will or with the urging of some family member. But you're here. Why is that? Did God not know your days before you were born? Christ chose to bear my sin and shame. Third is, Christ's blood cleanses my life. I loved how Simon said this morning that he was going to Jerusalem. Now, there was a protocol for being able to celebrate Passover. You could not be dirty at all. In other words, you had to be clean. You could have nothing that would harm you. And when he carried the cross for Christ, and how they pictured it is he had his armor on, Christ carrying it with him, Christ's blood went right on him. And he said, now I'm contaminated. I'm dirty. I'm unclean, unfit to celebrate the Passover. But as time went on, I think he came to realize that very blood that he thought made him unclean was the blood that actually cleansed him. You know, we live in a culture that is afraid of blood, and for many reasons. And you go into the hospital, and many of the garments are white. You can see, I think that's partly for cleanliness, so you can see. But we're afraid of blood. And yet, growing up and understanding the Bible, it's the blood of Christ that cleanses us to be pure before God. This is really a remarkable concept. In other words, when Christ impacts our life, that blood that he shed on the cross was not for him, it was for us. And it allows us to have a do-over. A do-over of life. You can start over, you can start anew and afresh. There's a new life. That's why they call it being born again. Have you ever come to the place where you're born again? Where you said, I get to start over. All that stuff that was done is in the past, and Christ died for that. And in my future too. And I can be cleansed. I can start over. Christ's response to suffering. I'd like you to turn to Luke chapter 23 for a minute. When Simon had gone and watched Christ crucified, he watched Christ interact with the people around him. Luke 23, Christ is on the cross. I'm going to start in verse 32. Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they were crucified along with other criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. And they divided up his garments by casting lots. Jesus looked around and he saw the soldiers and how they had treated him so vile. And now they were plotting his death. They had nailed him to the cross. And they were obviously mean to him. They were aggressive, the whole thing. And he said, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. Jesus forgave people when they were doing evil to him. Earlier in Christ's Sermon on the Mount, actually, when he was speaking, remember there's a section where he gives us what's called the Lord's Prayer. At the end of the Lord's Prayer is a couple verses. I'll just read them to you. It's out of Matthew 6. It says this, for if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sin, your Father will not forgive your sin. That's a really interesting concept. In other words, forgiveness is for us. God has forgiven us a truckload of stuff. And when somebody else does something wrong to us, or a little teaspoon of something, we as Christians are to forgive them. But the Bible says if you don't forgive them, then God will not forgive you. Where do you stand this morning with that? This whole concept of forgiveness. Are you set free or are you in bondage? What I'd like you to do is look at those four statements that we just made about Christ. Which one of those is new information for you? I would say circle it and ponder it today and this coming week. Second is, I'd like, you know, we watched Simon, Serene, speak about Christ going to the cross. I'd like to have you listen to someone who was there after Christ rose from the dead and get their perspective. This is Salome.
Not even sure how to start. What would be the word for terrified and excited. Do you know? Because we were both those things that, and my feet ran faster than I thought they could go. We had to tell everyone what had happened. But hold on, I'm getting ahead of myself. That Friday, when Jesus was crucified, it was all over. I mean, were we wrong about him? We must have been. Jesus was dead. And so we hid. We hid in fear. Until that Sunday morning, when a few of us women thought that we should go prepare his body with spices and ointments. It was the very least we could do, even if none of it made any sense. Those 3 days, the longest 3 days of my life, we were so afraid. Oh. But then, Sunday morning when we arrived, I swear my mind was racing faster than my feet as we ran from that tomb. I didn't know how we were going to explain this to the disciples. Massive, sealed tombstone, moved. Those Roman guards, silenced. Blinding angels and unnecessary grave clothes lying neatly folded and silent, almost as if they had a secret. You know how they say that a picture is worth 1,000 words? Well, if that's true, then that tomb, it holds 1,000 promises, because well, you see what it means, right? Here we were waiting for a Messiah to restore Israel. Well, didn't Jesus exceed all our expectations? He was a Messiah none of us could really understand, but wasn't that because we were hoping way too small? This means that whatever's been taken from us, God can restore. He lives so that we can live. Our greatest roadblock has been removed. Not even the doors of death can shut out the certainty of life with Jesus. Our strongest enemy? Defeated. So you tell me. What rival can possibly stand against him? Kings, presidents, the powers that be, whatever's happening now, and whatever's going to happen, from the highest of the highs to the lowest low, none of these things can make that tomb any less empty. Nothing. No temple veil, no checkered past, no hellish lie. None of it can stop the mortal from putting on immortality. He softened the sting of death, and he has swallowed our defeat in victory. Now, I'm no expert. I don't claim to know everything, but staring at those discarded grave clothes, those secret-keeping pieces of cloth? Secret's out. He's not dead. He's not missing. And he most certainly has not been taken away. He's alive. He walked out of that tomb, leaving death and those grave clothes behind. If there's a way to be had, it's through him. If there's hope in this world, his name is Jesus the Christ. He's alive, the Messiah, our Messiah, my Messiah. Yeah, Jesus. He's alive, all right. And the secret is out.
Go back to Mark chapter 15. Mark chapter 15 was where the crucifixion was being listed by Mark. It says this in verse 40. Some women were watching from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James the younger and of Joses, and Salome. In Galilee, these women had followed him, meaning Christ, and cared for his needs. Many other women had come up from Jerusalem, were out there also. Some interesting history about Salome that I've put in your notes here this morning. She was the sister of Mary, the mother of Jesus. She was her sister. And she was highly involved with this. She was the wife of Zebedee, the mother of James and John. And in Matthew 20:20, she was the mother. Remember, the disciples, James and John, had come to Christ and said, you know, we would like to sit at your right and left hand in the kingdom. Well, actually, the mother got involved in that. Salome got involved, and she came to Christ and said, now, my two boys, they're good boys. And I want them in this new kingdom that you're talking about. I want my two boys to be your right and left hand. She was the one that did that. She had lots of guts to do that, quite frankly, I think. But that's a mom. When Christ was crucified, she was there. She was watching, probably in disbelief. How could this happen? When all the other disciples were the ones that ran away, I find it fascinating that the women were the ones who were there. And they were checking it out and finding where Christ would be born, buried. Mark 16, 1 through 8, here's where it goes. And the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go to anoint Christ's body. Now what happened was, they took down Christ's body before the Sabbath, and they hurriedly put it on the side, because they didn't want to do things on the Sabbath. But they went to anoint the body, and they would wrap it up with cloth and spices to just make the smell better, of course, but also just to give it partly a decent burial. Verse 2, very early the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they're on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, who will roll away the stone from the entrance of the tomb? There was a big stone that had been rolled down into the place of where this tomb was. And they said, oh yeah, we got all these things, but how are we going to get in? They actually talked about it. These stones weighed hundreds of pounds. And in many cases were circular, and they just roll them in and they kind of sit, you know, would stay in that pace. You wouldn't be able to move them again, except with levers and that kind of thing. They said, who's going to open up the grave so we can go in there? Verse 4, but when they looked up, they saw the stone, which is very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw the young man dressed in white robes sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. It was an angel. He says, do not be alarmed. You're looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him? But go to his disciples and Peter. They singled out Peter, of course, because Peter had denied the Lord. He is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you. Trembling and bewildered, the women went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. That's where the ladies were. They were scared. The soldiers that had been put there to guard were gone. There's a whole different setting. The stone, by the way, was not rolled out for Jesus to get out of the tomb. It was rolled out so people could get into the tomb to see that he was gone. Christ was resurrected. In Matthew 28:9, it says that the resurrected Christ came to these women as they were going back to Jerusalem. And he showed them that he lived. He comforted them. And so they met with the resurrected Christ and were encouraged. And then it says they were excited and thrilled, and they ran to tell the disciples. Salome came to realize two personal truths, just like Simon did. Number 5 is the secret is out. My Messiah, or Christ, which is the New Testament word, lives. She saw him die. She saw where he was buried. and then she saw him raised from the dead. She was an eyewitness. Now, in Matthew 28, 11 through 15, when the guards came and told what had happened, those guards were punishable by death for leaving their post. You just don't do that in the Roman army. But what happened was the religious leaders bribed the guards, it says in Matthew 28, with a large sum of money to say this when people ask what happened. The disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep. Now, anyone who would know the guards would think that's craziness. Guards don't fall asleep, or they were punished by death. But that was the lie that they were told. The reality was, the disciples didn't have his body. Jesus had been raised from the dead. And finally, number six, this is what she also came to learn, is there is great hope in the world. His name is Jesus. We look out in our world, and our world needs some hope, wouldn't you say? I watch the news, and I see Kenya. And when the bandits were on the campus, they would ask people, "Are you a Christian?" What would you have said under those circumstances? What would you have said? I mean, I can say what I would hope I would say. There's life and death. But there is truth in a resurrected Christ. If he actually was raised from the dead, which the Bible states is true, which I believe, then we have hope as a person for eternal life, beyond this life. This past week, we had a funeral here in church. With a packed church. Justin Bagley's brother was killed in a snowmobile accident. And his friends and family came here, and we had a service. Justin told me earlier that his little boy, 4 years old, Timmy, saw his mom crying. Said, "Mommy, why are you crying? Is Uncle Mike still dead?" What was he saying? The little boy at 4 years old believes in the resurrection. He said there's truth to that. Then when we die, we are raised from the dead. And that's what he expected, fully expected. Do we expect that? Are you in a place where you can say, you know, one day I'll be resurrected with Christ? In your bulletins was a little track like this. And what I'd like to do is just share what the truth of that is for those of you who don't know. You see, the resurrection is very important to us. What it talks about is steps to peace with God, and man was originally designed to have fellowship with God, which he did. But man chose to go his own independent way, and fellowship with God was broken. And so what you have is man on this side, man, women, and children on this side, separated by a deep chasm to where God is on this side. The big difference is God is holy and righteous and honorable, and sin cannot be in his presence. And you have us as people on this side, who struggle with trying to keep the Ten Commandments. I'll ask that question again. Has anyone ever kept the Ten Commandments 100% with no failures? Go ahead and raise your hand. I'd like to meet you. No one ever raises their hand. Never. Well, then, if that is the standard which God said, and he's the one that wrote the playbook, then it's, what are we going to do? He's the playmaker, not me. So God looked down and he saw mankind was in trouble. The Bible says, for all have sinned and fall short of God's glory or perfect standard. And Christ raised his hand. He says, I will go. and I will pay the price. That's exactly what Christ came to do, was to live the life to show that he was God and then to die on the cross. And that cross bridged this gulf, which is thousands of miles wide and thousands of miles deep. You can never build a bridge out across. Well, men try. They try to be good. They try to give money. They try to help the poor. They try to do righteous things. But how much is enough? Nothing. The Bible says our good works are counted like filthy rags. So we can never build this bridge out to God again. So when Christ died on the cross bridged the gap from where man is to where God is. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Do you know that this morning? Have you come to terms with that? I met with someone recently and said, "Do you know?" There's two questions that are asked. One is, would you know for certain that you would go to heaven if you died today? Yes or no? Most people say, I don't know, or I think so. Do you know for certain? The second question is this, which really clarifies it. If you were to die and stand before God and he were to say, why should I let you into my heaven? What would you tell him? Which is a very fair question. What would you tell God? You're going to hold up your trophies, what you did good, and say, here you go. Here's my portfolio. He'll say, that's not good enough. That's not. None of it is. He'll say, did you believe in me and what I did on the cross? Because Jesus Christ paid for our sin on the cross. He was the perfect lamb, the perfect scenario. So here's what we need to do to be joined with God. Is where are you on this picture? Are you over here far from God, away from God? Are some of you on the cross and considering Christ? I know a number of you are over here with God. You've committed your life to Christ. So I'm going to offer you a chance to pray and wrestle with this issue. Some of you are ready to say, I commit my life to Christ this day. Easter's a good day for that. Let's pray. Father, this morning, I listen to these stories. I hear the word of God and I realize that I am far from God. I realize that there's nothing I can do to get back holy with God again. I can't meet that standard of perfection. But I believe that Jesus Christ died in my place. He hung on my cross. He suffered my shame. And I am so grateful. I ask you to forgive me of my sin and apply that to my account and set me free. I believe that Christ will one day come back for me. It is an awesome privilege to be a child of the King. Forgive me, Lord, for my sin. Take me for who I am. Change my life. And I look forward to being with you forever. Thank you for hearing my prayer. In Christ's name, amen.